the Bible studies have been, like, interesting.
Yeah. Are we done with our assignments?
All the questions on how God answered prayer, and let's go to the cafeteria and get something to eat.
It says here we're supposed to end our Bible study with a prayer.
Well, what should we pray?
I know. Now I lay me down to sleep, a bag of peanuts at my feet.
Not that one.
Besides, I don't like the dying part that comes after it.
What should we do then?
It's gotta be easy. I don't want to think too hard.
And quick. I'm hungry.
How about the Lord's Prayer?
Perfect. You start.
Okay. Our Father, which art in heaven.
Yes.
Did you say something?
Like what?
Never mind. Our Father, which art in heaven.
Yes.
Don't interrupt me while I'm praying.
I didn't say anything.
You called me. What's on your mind?
I didn't call you. I was just saying the Lord's Prayer.
Who's he talking to?
I have no idea.
Hallowed be thy name.
Hold it. What did you mean by that?
By what?
Hallowed be thy name.
How am I supposed to know what it means? It's just a part of the prayer.
He's flipping out.
If you really want to know, it means holy and sacred.
Really? Well, that kind of makes sense. Maybe you should take it from here.
Okay. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Do you really mean that?
Whoa, who said that?
Not me. Freaky, ain't it?
Are you advancing my kingdom by doing my will?
Well, I go to church and youth camps.
That's not what I asked. Are you controlling your temper? Are you setting an example of Christian love and charity? Or are you going to convince and doing your own thing?
Stop picking on me. I don't have a temper.
Yes, you do.
Shut up. Besides, I'm better than some of the other people who go to church.
Excuse me? I thought you were praying for my will to be done, not yours.
I can't handle this kind of pressure.
Personally, I think you're both cracking up.
You think you're so smart? You try it.
Okay. Give us this day our daily bread.
Do you mean that?
What?
Do you really trust me to supply you with all your basic needs?
I don't know, man. I'm doing just fine on my own. Besides, I don't really like bread. Now where was that? Oh yeah. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors.
What about Jason?
What about that good-for-nothing slime bucket?
Who did just ask me to forgive you just as you forgave Jason?
I can't forgive him. He told lies about me.
Yeah, but you did say
it. I didn't mean it, okay? I can't handle this any longer. I want revenge. I won't listen. I won't.
What about you?
What?
Will you forgive?
Yeah. I can forgive my sister for running me out of my parents.
Then I can forgive you.
Good.
Now don't you feel renewed?
Yes, I do, Lord. Thank you. Amen.
Wait a minute. You're not through with the prayer.
Right. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Good. I'll do that. Just don't put yourself in a place where you can be tempted.
What do you mean?
Quit hanging around with that group that's always getting you into trouble. Change some of your friends.
But...
Don't be fooled. They like to make you think they're having fun, but they're heading straight for destruction. They will snare you into their plans, and then you'll come crying to me to bail you out.
I don't understand.
Sure you do. You have done it lots of times. You get yourself in a bad situation, and then you make all sorts of promises to me if I will only help you get out of your mess. Promises that you don't even intend to keep.
But they're my friends.
You want to stay out of temptation? Stay away from them. Can't you see they are leading you down the wrong path?
No, I can't see. I don't want to see.
Well?
Well, what?
Aren't you going to finish the prayer?
Sure. Now let me down to sleep with a bag of peanuts at my feet.
That's not what you were praying.
I know, but it's the only safe prayer I can think of. Until now, I thought the Lord's Prayer was just something you said when you couldn't think of anything else to say. I never thought you actually, listened.
I listen in more ways than you know. Now go ahead. Finish your prayer.
Okay. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Do you know what would really bring me glory?
No, but I have a hunch you're going to tell me.
Commit your life totally to me.
Commit my life?
Yeah. Dedicate your whole being to me. Your thought life, your will, your actions. Give it all to me and we can do great things together.
I can't give my life to you. I want to do my own thing. I won't say it. I won't.
Anyone else want to pray? Figures. This happens a lot. You can shut me out, but I'll keep speaking. You can live your life and pretend I don't exist, but I will always be with you.
We pray all the time. We pray at church, before we eat, and even when we go to bed each night. But do we really mean what we say? Do we really want to hear His voice? Do we really want to see what He's trying to reveal in our lives? Do we really want to say what He truly wants us to say? Praying should not just be a habit, and it should never be taken lightly. It is literal talking to God, and it's a key element to our relationship with Him. Every time you pray, remind yourself that God is listening and He wants to have an actual conversation with you. What if there was someone who said the exact same thing every time you talked to them? Would you really want to have a friendship relationship with them? No. But it's the same way with God. He doesn't want you to say the same thing every time you talk to Him. That's why, even though something like the Lord's Prayer is good, it should not be what you say every time we talk to Him. And it definitely shouldn't be something you say when you can't think of anything to say. Because maybe when you're lost for words, God's just trying to tell us to be quiet and listen to Him speaking. I hope you don't want God to not interrupt you while you're praying.
Thank you.
Him and I were not a church-going family until 2012. We tried to go to church, but it really didn't preach the Bible. It just gave its own opinion on Jesus and the Bible. My sisters tried to get us to come to Stokely's, and we kept saying we would. This went on for about a month until we finally decided to come. That night, we all, as in my family, felt something. Now in the year of 2014, my whole family has been saved and baptized. Both of my parents were saved on October 22nd, 2012. I was saved on December 23rd, 2012. All three of my sisters were saved on January 13th, 2013. My whole family got baptized February 3rd, 2013. We are so thankful to have a church that preaches the word and treats us like family.
Amen.
Thank God for your time.
Wow.
We pray for blessings. We pray.
Servants, there were still ranks, and Satan used to be the most powerful and beautiful one. His name was Lucifer, meaning morning star. But he wasn't satisfied. His pride got the best of him. And in Isaiah 14, 12 through 14, we see, "How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which didst weaken the nations? For thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven, I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High." He wanted to be like the Most High, and he wanted to have the image of God, but God said no. And he resisted God's sovereign plan. In Ezekiel 28:15-16, it says, "Thou wast perfect in the ways from the day that thou wast created, till iniquity was found in thee. By the multitude of thy merchandise, thou hast filled the midst of thee with violence, and thou hast sinned. Therefore, I will cast thee down as profane out of the mount of God, and I will destroy thee, O covering cherub, from the midst of the sons of fire." And because of this rebellion and because of this pride, he was cast out of heaven. His name became Satan, meaning adversary or resister. So that's Satan, an angel corrupted by pride, then eventually got the best of him. Next is the most timeless enemy in our lives, sin. Turn to me with me to Genesis 2:7. It says, "And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground, and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul." First of all, man was made of dust. I know this doesn't really seem that important, but it will be. And man was made with the perfect idea of love. First off, loving for loving God. Man was made to love God. Unlike angels, man was not made to serve God, but to love him. And second, loving others. In verse 18, it says, "And the Lord God said, it is not good that man should be alone. I will make him and help meet for him." So Eve was made for Adam to love, but it never mentions, thirdly, a love for self. Self-love did not exist in any way, shape, or form. In Genesis 1:26, it says, "And God let us make man in our image. And God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth." There was immediate controversy between man and Satan. Can you imagine the jealousy of Satan? Here, the very thing that he wanted has been given to man, the image of God. So, Satan came down in the form of a serpent. In Genesis 3:1-6, it says, "Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field, which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, Yea, hath God said, ye shall not eat of the tree of the garden? And the woman said unto the serpent, We may eat of the tree of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God hath said, ye shall not eat of it. Neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die. And the serpent said unto the woman, Ye shall not surely die, for God doth not know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil." So Satan persuaded Eve to eat the forbidden fruit, which is the first sin of man. But of course, every sin has a punishment. The very first punishment is evident in Genesis 3:12-13. And the man said, "The woman thou gavest to me, she gave me of the tree, and I did eat. And the Lord God said, Woman, what is that thou hast done? And the woman said, The serpent beguiled me, and I did eat." It's evident that there is a twisted love. Before, if something like this would have happened, Adam would have said, "Yes, Lord, it was my fault. I sinned." Because he would have loved Eve more than himself. And he would have rather himself be blamed than Eve. This is where we see the first evidence of man starting to love self more than God and others. Instead of everyone taking blame upon themselves, they shifted it to someone else, which is a huge red flag of self-love. And then, as the curses come on, in verse 14 through 17, the Lord God said to the serpent, "Because thou hast done this, thou art cursed above all cattle and above every beast of the field. Upon thy belly shalt thou go, and dust shalt thou eat all the days of thy life. I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel." "Woman," he said, "I will greatly multiply thy sorrow and conception. In sorrow thou shalt bring forth children, and thy desire shall be to thy husband, and he shall rule over thee." And unto Adam he said, "Because thou hast hearkened unto the voice of thy wife, and hast eaten of the tree of which I commanded thee, saying, Thou shalt not eat of it. Cursed is the ground for thy sake, and sorrow shalt thou eat of it in all the days of thy life." The curses were, first, Adam's curse, manual labor. Man was cursed with the first ever manual labor, keeping food on the table. What used to be a step outside in a tree that needed no maintaining was now something you had to work hard for. And then second was Eve's curse, depression and childbirth. Woman was cursed with the very first pain. When life used to be a walk in the park, it was now becoming a sorrowful world. And then the serpent's curse, depravity. What used to be a perfect world was now a world full of evil creatures, sinful men, and immoral beings. And then, after God gives serpent's curse, he gives a prophecy. In Genesis 3:14, at the last part, he says, "Upon thy belly shalt thou go, and dust shalt thou eat all the days of thy life." We are made of dust. What God is saying is that Satan will battle man for the rest of their lives. And then in Genesis 15 it says, "And I will put enmity between thee and thy woman, and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel." Enmity will be between the children of Eve and the children of Satan, the moral and the immoral. We see this evident every day, contention between the moral and the immoral. That's why we have wars, murders, and abuse. And then there's the overall punishment for sin. Then and there, man began to die. Before they had never aged, but everything had changed. So that's sin, the most depressing topic I can think of except for hell itself. But now we can finally get on a brighter subject, the Savior. Turn with me to John 3:13. "And no man hath ascended up to heaven, but he that came down from heaven, even the Son of Man which is in heaven. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of God be lifted up, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God so loved the world, that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. He that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already, because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten Son." Jesus was fully God and fully human at the same time, so he was the only perfect human. And he came down, hoping he could convert the world, when instead they rejected him. In John 19... 25, it says, "Now there stood by the cross of Jesus his mother, and his mother's sister Mary, the wife of Cleophas, and Mary Magdalene. Then Jesus therefore saw his mother, and the disciple standing by, whom he loved. He said unto his mother, Woman, behold thy son. Then he said to the disciple, Behold thy mother. And from that hour the disciple took her into his house. And after this, Jesus, knowing that all things were now accomplished, that the scripture might be fulfilled, say it, I thirst. Now there was a set a vessel full of vinegar, and they filled a sponge with vinegar and put it upon hyssop and put it in his mouth. When Jesus therefore had received the vinegar, he said, "It is finished," and he bowed his head and gave up his ghost. Jesus died on the cross for us. Jesus was the only perfect human, the only human that did not deserve the punishment for sin, which is death. But he died anyways. He took upon himself all of our sins and died for our iniquities. He was punished for something we did, but he did it voluntarily, so that we could go to heaven when our life is over. Turn to 1 Corinthians 15, 50. Now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, neither doth corruption inherit incorruption. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruption shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought past the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, who giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. One day we will be caught up to meet the Lord in the air, and our mortal bodies will be changed to immortal ones.
Yeah.
And guess what? We won't be made of dust anymore. Satan has lost his grip over us. Satan will no longer have power and control over us.
Yeah.
And then in Isaiah 1:18. Says, though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. Our sins will be washed away in white as snow. We will forever be present with the Lord one day. So that's it. That's the plan of salvation. Satan no longer has power over us. Sin has been washed away. And the Savior, well, he made it all possible. That's Satan's sin and Savior.
How many want to just take a few laps around the building right now? After them testimonies and hearing that good singing, and I'm just thrilled today.
Amen.
God's doing something in our children here, and not just the teenagers, but even the small ones. And I'm so proud. I want you to turn very briefly to Mark chapter 10. I just want to wrap this thing up. Mark chapter 10. Verse 13, and Austin did a great job. Alan, your testimony. Devin, Marley, Katie singing, Dakota playing. Who'd I leave out? Alyssa's going to play here in a minute. She's going to play the offertory for us. And youth choir, outstanding job, that new song. And I'm just so proud of it. I really am. Mark chapter 10, 13 through 16. And they brought young children to him that he should touch them. And his disciples rebuked them, those that brought them. But when Jesus saw it, he was much displeased and said unto them, "Suffer the little children to come unto me, and forbid them not, for of such is the kingdom of God. Verily I say unto you, whosoever shall not receive the kingdom of God as a little child, he shall not enter therein." And he took them up in his arms, put his hands on them, and blessed them. I'm glad that we have a ministry to children. And I love all these kids. I mean, Devin, man, he was trying to get himself psyched up before he gave his testimony. Did y'all see that? Once he got there, he got out that piece of paper and went through it. Man, it was good, brother. But he had to get it worked up, didn't he? And that was great. And every one of these have been used by God tonight to be a blessing to us. And it brings me to mind this story. Bringing children to God's house is so important. These children were brought to Jesus one day, and the disciples weren't too for it. I mean, they weren't for it too much, and they kind of rebuked them and said, no, now wait a minute, Jesus is tired. Jesus said he needs to conserve his strength. We need to protect his time. And they were kind of keeping the children away from him. He strongly rebuked them. Said, wait a minute, let them come. Even this morning in the service, Carlissa came to me first. She was sitting over here and, or somewhere. She found me somewhere and she said, did you see Miss Eula Dean? And she was telling me, I told y'all about that this morning. Well, then after the service, little Rue comes up to me, steps up on the platform, and she wants to give her preacher a hug. And I said, you have a good time in there? She said, yes, I did. I said, well, we had a good time in here, too. And then Waylon comes up next, all right? So all three of them are getting in on this thing. And, man, don't they feel like part of the family here? And that's the kind of kids that we love. And I'm glad we're being able to minister to them. And I'm thankful for the job Tim and Aggie are doing. And Waylon gave me a big old hug and said he had a great time in his class during church. And I'm so glad that we have a privilege to pray for them. We have something going on for them here at the church. We're teaching them the Word of God. They're able to go to a Sunday school class that's brightly decorated. And they've got a teacher that loves them. And they're being taught the Word of God on their level. Now that's at 10 o'clock on Sunday mornings. And what a privilege. I know our teachers are having a time. And some of our teachers, Denise and Julia, that had the real little ones for months. I know it was months. I know it was weeks, but I think it was even several months. They didn't have a soul. And we were just praying and waiting and saying, God, whenever you send them, we got two teachers here that are going to teach them. And finally, God opened the door. When Tim and Aggie got their three, and then it just seemed like there was more coming. And now, y'all have had as high as how many? They've had as high as 9. Amen? We need to pray for them, don't we? All right? And I went by there today, and I saw their class, and I saw Cheryl's class, and Doris's class. Then I went by and saw Cindy and Linda's. And every one of them had kids in them. Then I went to the teen room and saw the teen class. And it just blessed my heart to know that we've got something for them, and we are to receive children with open arms just like Jesus did. And I'm glad we have a church like that, aren't you? And boy, God's working in their lives. These are not shallow testimonies. That was not a shallow message, amen? Satan, sin, and the Savior. How many can remember that, amen? Good plan of salvation, and what a good message. And I did not help him. I don't want y'all to think, you know, we pour over that. I just let him have it, amen? He got up before I did this morning. My alarm went off at 6:30. I walked through the house. Austin, he comes out of the bathroom in his suit. And I said, brother, what's going on? He said, I've got to study. I said, you've already showered and everything? He said, yes, sir. And he said he had to finish his message. Amen. So he was up bright and early. Woo, that's good right there. You know, why would the disciples rebuke the people? And why would the disciples try to keep the children away from Jesus? And they thought they were doing a favor by keeping them away. But I'm telling you, children are a treasure from God.
Amen.
And now I will say, children are a lot of hard work. Tim and Aggie, would y'all come give a testimony to that? No, I'm just playing. I think you could, though, couldn't you, brother? They're a lot of hard work. And they've experienced that recently. And you that have raised your children, now you have grandkids. And we've raised our three. And I can't believe Alan's going to turn 18 in April. And now Austin's 14, Katie's 20. It's just amazing how they grow and how they grow so fast. But children are a lot of hard work. Children are a lot of trouble. I have to just punch that in there. We had a lock-in recently. And the teens got on the organ when they weren't supposed to. Hallelujah, amen. And it messed up the organ. It popped the breaker on the organ. Well, we were distraught. We thought, oh my goodness. And my first thought is, Hubert's going to kill me. You know, right? And I was worried about it. I got the workers worried about it. I got the teens worried about it. And you know what? I went to the deacon's meeting that Sunday morning. And the first thing out of their mouth was, you know what? Kids will be kids.
Yeah, that's right.
Don't worry about it. Let it roll off. It may cost us a little bit of money to get it fixed. No big deal.
Right.
And I was like, hallelujah, praise the Lord. You know what? And I look back to that incident, and I think, you know what? I should have let that just roll off my sleeve.
Yeah.
That ain't no big deal. Amen?
Right.
And if we're going to reach kids and teens, we may not have the cleanest building because they're going to mark up the walls. Amen? They may rip up a pew every now and then. I hope they don't, right?
Yeah.
But things like that may happen.
Yes.
But you know what? We're going to put up with that because of what we've seen tonight. Amen?
Yeah.
And I just love that we want to reach kids. Now, the disciples didn't consider children to be important. But how many of y'all consider children to be very important?
Amen.
I'm talking about every age. Now, Jesus took them up in his arms. He touched them. He blessed them. And boy, Jesus was very displeased with those old disciples. He became indignant. He openly rebuked them for standing in the way. Now, let's not stand in the way. And here at Stokely's Chapel, let's consider children to be very important. I'm glad we do.
Yeah.
We have something for them. Everyone can be a part. Everyone has a Sunday school class to go to. Children are important. And together, we can train up children in the way that they should go. Now, I want you to turn to one more scripture. Look over to Proverbs. I'm going to let you look at several, but Proverbs 1, let's see. Let's go to Psalm 127. Psalm 127. Then we're going to go to Proverbs. Psalm 127. This morning, Nikki gave a great testimony about her kids. Just thankful for her family. And it made me think of this verse. Psalm 127:3. Lo, children are an heritage of the Lord, and the fruit of the womb is His reward. You know, children are on loan from God to us. Now, He gives us that responsibility to raise them in the nurture and admonition of God. But they're just on loan to us. They're not our property. They belong to God. And He's given us the special task to train them and to instruct them. And I just want to give you three simple things and we'll go home tonight. Number one, we are to be an example to them. We are to set the example for them. In Proverbs 20, verse 7, I'll just read a few Proverbs. You don't have to try to keep up with me. But just you might just want to write these down. Proverbs 27. It says, the just man walketh in his integrity. His children are blessed after him. You say, my children ain't walking with the Lord. Well, maybe you need to check up on your relationship with God and make sure you're walking in integrity. Because they're looking at you, big boy. They're watching how you respond. They're seeing if you're faithful to the house of God and how committed you are to God's Word and to a daily walk with the Lord. See, the way the parents act in the home teaches children more about God than what they hear in the Sunday school class and than what they hear in church. Guess who said that? Benjamin Franklin. They learn more what in viewing their parents in the home than they do here at church. And if parents are walking with God, boy, they can give their children a heritage that will enrich them throughout the rest of their lives. Now, parents and grandparents, somebody's watching you. And man, I hope you're walking with God. Godliness puts beauty in a home, and it puts protection around the house. Amen? That's what godliness will do. It's a beautiful thing. It'll beautify your home, and it will put protection around your house. And Proverbs 14:26 says, in the fear of the Lord is strong confidence, and His children shall have a place of refuge. Hey, the fear of God will put that protection around us. See, the world wants to penetrate those walls of our house. The devil's trying to get in at every little crack he can, right, Alan? Y'all went through that. Hey, every opportunity, Satan's trying to pound down those walls. And he doesn't want us to rest in Jesus. But godly parents will keep them walls strong, and boy, they'll have their weapons drawn on a regular basis. See, if a parent's walking with God, we have our weapons, the sword of the Spirit and the shield of faith, and we have prayer and we have all those mighty things that we need to have our weapons drawn and ready for the enemy to attack. He wants to penetrate your house. He wants to penetrate my house. He wants to penetrate this house. So that's why we got to be on guard. We got to set the example. Are we setting the example for our kids? Number two, then we got to instruct them. Proverbs 6, verse 20 says, My son, keep thy father's commandments and forsake not the law of thy mother. How in the world are our kids going to learn what the Word of God says? How are they going to be trained in what is right and what is wrong? It takes a godly mother, a godly father, or a godly grandparent, godly uncle or aunt, or whoever's called on to take care of these kids. Hey, we're supposed to instruct them. Yes, we're supposed to set the example, and then we're supposed to instruct them. Proverbs 19:27. Let me read that one for you. Cease, my son, to hear the instruction that causeth to err from the words of knowledge. Hey, we're supposed to teach them what's right and what's wrong, and then tell them not to sway off the path. Keep following God. Keep listening to the Word of God. And I'm telling you, as I get older, as I got older, it seemed like my parents got wiser. Right? When I was a teenager, I thought I knew everything, and I thought they were crazy. But then, when I got out on my own, I realized, man, my daddy was brilliant. Amen? And now I wish I could call him and get some advice and talk to him again. And I don't have that privilege. And you know what? We've got to listen to these ones that have wisdom, godly wisdom from God's Word. You know, the basic textbook in the home should be the Word of God. Now, I know they got to take all them other textbooks home, but that's not the most important textbook they've got at home. It is the Word of God. And a lot of times we spend money, time, and energies on sports or special activities to get our kids where they need to be, but I'm telling you, we ought to be more concerned that our children are excelling and obeying the blessed book. That's more important than any sports. And I watched a ball game today, but you know what? That ain't most important, right? And we've got to make sure we're training them, instructing them. Proverbs 13:1 says, a wise son heareth his father's instruction, but a scorner heareth not rebuke. I tell you, our kids need to learn early to obey and do what's right from God's Word. Because then they'll grow up if they don't, and they'll be a scorner, and they won't hear rebuke, and they'll be in a mess one day. Then number 3, and I'll close. Not only do we need to set the example, we need to instruct them, but we need to give them loving discipline. Proverbs 13:24 says, he that spareth his rod hateth his son, but he that loveth him chastens him betimes or many times or disciplines him. Now that doesn't mean brutality, amen? It just means guide them, prepare them for adulthood, correct the character flaws, correct their childish thinking and their childish ways while there's still time to do it. A lot of times, parents wait till it's too late. It's too late to do the discipline and the instructing and the setting of the example, and they've waited too long. It's better that a child be corrected by his parents than law enforcement. Amen. Hallelujah. Yeah. Amen. Amen. And so we need to be doing our job. Proverbs 17:18 says, a man void of understanding striketh hands and becometh surety in the presence of his friends. I'm telling you, we've got to give them that understanding. And that takes discipline. And it's so important. Children cannot be left to themselves. They need boundaries. Within boundaries, that's where we find true freedom. Amen? And you're going to have, if you're not disciplining your children, that probably means you have a hard time disciplining yourself. So we just got to do it. Let's stand up and do it. Proverbs 29:15, 2 more verses. The rod and reproof give wisdom, but a child left to himself bringeth his mother to shame. Correct thy son, and he shall give thee rest. Yea, he shall give delight unto thy soul. Great principle from God's Word. Now Proverbs 22:6, train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. I love that scripture. That gives us a lot of hope. Now that's not a religious rabbit's foot that we can just grab onto and say, and I know they'll stray away for a while, but they'll come back. You know, that may not always be true. But here's a good principle in God's Word. Here's what the principles actually say. It says if they're raised in wisdom, if they're raised in the way of the Lord, and we'll set the example for them, we'll instruct them, and we'll discipline them, then they won't ever stray away in the first place. Amen? Isn't that our desire? Now, many of you have someone that's one of your kids that's strayed or a grandkid, but I'm telling you, at those prayers will always be heard. We should keep on praying. Amen. And God's planted that seed in their hearts. I know many kids that were raised up in this church and they heard the Word of God And they did get a godly example from their parents. They were instructed. They were disciplined. Hey, we just need to keep praying for them. The power of Satan has been too strong in their life and they've gotten off track. Hey, let's not give up on them. Amen. Somebody didn't give up on you. And you may have a wayward one here tonight or out in the world tonight. But you know what? If our children end up a sluggard or a glutton or a fornicator or a robber, it should not be in spite of the training. It should not be because of us while they're there. It should be in spite of the training they got. And even though they were raised in the Word of God, we try to raise them the right way. They have a free will, and they have to choose their own way. So if you've got a child tonight that needs to get back to the Lord, man, we want to pray for them. We want to do everything we can to be a support. But I'm telling you, if they're still in your home, you still got a chance. You still got time. Set that example. Give them instruction and discipline while you can. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Every head bowed, every eye closed.